And then the commentary begins, as we just read, "For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him." In other words, in this case, all means all. And that includes the angels, doesn't it? But here's the significance of establishing that the Son is greater than the angels that we've been spending all this time on here in chapter 1 and up till now. Picking up where we left off in verse 8. "But now we do not yet see all things put under him, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone." This begins the discussion that really will dominate the rest of the book about what Jesus has done for all people, you, me, and everybody else. If we put aside in our minds that little four-verse exhortation that started chapter 2, and you go back to how chapter 1 ended, you remember the last Old Testament quote in chapter 1, "Sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool." And now, what do we have? Putting all things in subjection under his feet, his footstool. So you see how they're connected here? And all means all, but a rather obvious point is now made. We don't now see this, do we? Jesus is up there exalted at the right hand of the Father. "Sit in my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool." The only problem is, all things are not under subjection yet. Now, as we've been going through our passages each week, I've mentioned Jesus regularly. But please note, the writer in this book has been talking about the Son of God, now bringing out the Son of Man, that messianic title, and only at this point do we actually see the name of Jesus first mentioned. So here is where he brings the identification. Who is the Son of God? Who is the Son of Man we're talking about? I don't see everything under this guy's feet. World seems pretty messed up. Well, here's what we see. We see Jesus, and there he is ID'd for us. Now, you mention Jesus. You mention this Jewish rabbi who was executed by a collaboration of the Jewish and Roman states of government. How in the world could this guy be greater than the angels, like you've been talking about for the last chapter and a half? But the point is made. He was deliberately made lower than the angels. It was a choice. When he took on humanity, he was making a choice to deliberately lower himself, and that choice was made for a specific purpose, for the suffering of death. You see, angels, not being physical beings but spirit beings, they don't die. So in that sense, angels are greater than any human being, because we all die. Angels don't. But Jesus was deliberately made human for the purpose of death. And there are two ways to look at the Greek here about a little lower than the angels. And you'll notice, even if you're looking at a New King James, that there is a footnote there. Because one way of translating this, besides a little lower, is rather than do it in sort of a spatial sense, like something is less than something else, is to look at it from a temporal sense, the sense of time. And so therefore, if you look at it from the time idea, then the better translation would be, was made for a little while lower than the angels. And I buy in with that view. as do a large number of the Greek scholars that I look at. Made, for a little while, lower than the angels. Not always a little lower than the angels, no. The idea is that for that period of time there, when he was on earth, for a little while, he was lower than the angels for the suffering of death. Now, don't run with that to great extremes and forget this fundamental fact. When Jesus made the decision to become a human being, it was an eternal decision. That choice was not to be a human being for those 33 years or whatever. It was a choice for all time. Fully God, fully human, forever. So when you read that for a little while, don't throw that fact out. That's not the point the writer's trying to get at here. The point is, for that short period of time, in his humiliation, as he walked the earth, lower than the angels for the suffering of death, but now, what? Crowned with glory and honor, as he's risen from the dead, ascended to heaven, and again, sitting at the right hand of the Father. This choice of Jesus was deliberate. It was for a purpose. Why did Jesus come to earth? To teach us some neat stuff? To do a lot of miracles? To be some great philosopher? No, he came to die. He came to die. Let us never, ever think of Jesus on the same level as anyone of the Bible. Moses, Abraham, David. No, no, no. And certainly not anyone else in human history like Buddha, Confucius, Muhammad, Plato or Aristotle. No. Jesus alone is God incarnate, God in human flesh. He deliberately took on humanity for the purpose of death. And why did he do it? By the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone, and that includes every one of us. A gift of God's grace to you and to me. That's what the coming of Jesus Christ is all about. A gift for us.